Hi everyone, I'm Jason E. Bowman. I work at the Valand Academy at the University of Gothenburg in Sweden alongside the two people who present for this panel. It's always fun to get the post-lunch slump session, you know, sort of, and in this situation I guess that's intensified because it's also post-coital thanks to Rosalie. But I hope everybody's had the chance to become lubricated over lunch. I am going to, in the interest of time, not go through the bios of our two speakers, which are in the written paper, just so we can maybe try and claim a few minutes back for ourselves. I'm currently trying to locate the first speaker, who I don't think is actually in the room yet. So I will provide some bio for her. Professor Andrea Phillips is past professor at the Valand Academy at the University of Gothenburg. I'm sure many of us are familiar with her work, which interrogates a set of both political and socioeconomic conditions around both art production and in the production or manifestations of publics, which in recent years she has been making a call for the dissolution of the use of the terminology around publics, and partly in order to suggest that we can then begin to sort of repurpose the frameworks of institutions themselves, for which she also claims that perhaps we should be dealing with the meso-interstitial possibilities of organisation instead of solely focusing on the macro question of institutionalisation or the micro level of subjects. She'll be followed by Dr. Nick Wilson, who is prefect of the Valand Academy at the University of Gothenburg, who I'm sure many of us are aware of has been interrogating a set of questions around the notion of curating publics and education with a set of works and co-edited volumes that have become sort of seminal in the field. So I'll pretend to be Andrea till she gets here. Well, he makes now going out as well. So, you know, so Dave and I both work them, so you can do pretty good impersonations of both. So who do you want to be, Dave? Do you want to be Andrea this time?
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Professor Andrea Phillips.
Did he say nice things about me?
Yeah.
The ICA and its financial, I'm not going to do a big anti-ICA thing. I worked here as an unpaid intern, very meaning like a right to say. This is in fact a private hire for the ICA, this event, which is not a criticism, it's just to try to join some of the things that I want to say today to the previous discussion before lunch. But actually this is now the mechanism through which intellectual and artistic, or maybe intellectuals hyphen artistic labour or curatorial labour is carried out, is largely through it within nominally state-funded institutions such as the ICA, is largely through private hiring. So the way in which this event has taken place is through a collaboration, a financial collaboration and an intellectual collaboration between the Chelsea School of Art, or the University of the Arts, I think in a larger sense, and looking at Malcolm for affirmation of that, Valand Academy, where I work, and Mick and Jason work as well. And the way that this kind of event can happen is that the ICA needs it to be paid for by external institutions because it can't afford to pay for it itself, or chooses not to apportion the small amount of money that is part of the overall state funding for the ICA that is able to be given to programming, because of course that's a very minor part of any institutional budget nowadays, which is why you go to get sponsorship for particular exhibitions, which is why you have headline sponsors, etc., etc., which comes back to Mel's conversation about oil this morning. And so this is effectively a private hire. So when you hire the Tate, the ICA for an event, you not only pay for the speakers and the hire of the space, but you also pay for the technical support, etc., etc. That's all included in it. So just to make that clear, yeah. So now, this is not something that is unusual. Most institutions supplement the diminishing income they receive from the state within the UK and other places, including the fabled Norway, to come back to the conversation about Norway paying artists or no longer paying artists. It's an increasing paradigm within artistic culture within Northern Europe. Of course, dominantly within the USA, because of course every exemplification or affective ontological imaginary of institution that has been referred to so far within today's discussions have been mainly Western ideas of what an art institution or an institution might be. So within the USA, there is, virtually no public funding at all. In the UK, there is some public funding, and within the Scandinavian states where I now work, there is much more public funding. But again, they're looking to look at the kind of neoliberalization of capital. Where's Doe? I thought I'd look at him when I say capital. I knew I was on track. he's taking notes. So there's an increasing kind of looking towards this model by the Scandinavian states as well. I've just come back from Norway, where often I think the reason I get invited to these things is because they imagine that some of my neoliberal training might rub off on them. Right, so what I want to talk about today is precisely this, and I think to return to some of the issues that Dave developed in his introduction today, to look at the situation now between monopoly capitalism, effectively, and disbursements of that within arts institutions, and to think about this conceptualization of the relationship between capital and capitalism that maybe Dave could enter into discussion a bit with me about afterwards, because I think it'd be quite good to clarify what those two things are. Because it would seem to me that at the moment, the other thing I wanted to say is I'm talking in defense of sociology, Dave. I think that whilst I too have read my economics, and I must take my hat off to you for having gone through all that material, because I certainly haven't. But I think sociology and contextual understandings of the art world are super important, and they're super important politically. Now, I know Dave wasn't saying that they're not, but this my discussion comes from a sociological, cultural studies position, really. I want to talk about institutions, and I want to talk about we've been builders managing change. So I want to talk about institutional change, and really pick up on some of the ideas that came out of Mel and Rosalie's discussion or performance or whatever we want to call it that happened this morning. But what I think what's important first is for us to recognise that concepts of value are no longer. It's no longer possible to talk about concepts of value in simple ways. So not that anybody particularly has yet, but I think it's really important for us to recognise that value accrual within the arts, within the art object, if we can call it that, is a very complex map of situated categories and assemblages. So value accrual now must be recognised, and is recognised increasingly by sociologists of value, as multivalent, trans-historical, and transnational. Now, if one thinks about how that value accrual might work within a piece of artwork, say Rosalie's performance from earlier on today, if we understand that as a work, then one can understand that it develops value not simply through its attributes of labour, its attributes of skill or talent, as Dave talked about earlier on today in reference to a particular historical model he was laying out, but also in terms of its relationship to a history of gender positionality, to a history of feminism, to a history of exhibitions and performance events within conferences that also relate to those things. It also accrues value through its position within a transnational or trans-territorial art world, in which its position at the ICA on Saturday, the whatever of February, it will be read historically, as she suggested, as something that fits into a map of other, you know, feminist, anti-capitalist positions, oppositional to the art world events that have occurred trans-historically, and all of those things are part of its value accrual. And that value accrual will relate directly, of course, as she understood, to her ability to pay herself and indeed her notoriety as an artist within the future. So, value accrual is now recognised within sociologies of labour value and commodity value as multivalent, transhistorical, and transnational. So we need to move from that to the next stage, yeah? Which is not to say that we can't criticise that as a set of operatives within value creation, but we need to move to the next stage in order to think about what we're going to do with that, and whether we're happy with that situation, and how we want to change it. And this is where a question of institution and institutionality comes in. Obviously, people are familiar with institutional critique, artists and curators making work that opposes the institutions but sits within the institutions, so creating a kind of paradox or, you know, contradictory ambivalence within the politics of art. We can now see that as having occurred within the West in the 80s and 90s in most major art museums and galleries across that territory, including the ICA. I know, because I was being an unpaid intern there. And you know, wiping artists' bottoms and things like that. That's what you had to do then. Sitting on artists' knees. Right. So what are we going to do within this kind of homologized, naturalized process where indeed the Tate does rely, actually much more heavily than Mel indicated, I think, I don't know where Mel is, but on private capital. It's more or less 85% sponsored.
No, it's not.
It is.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
How long do you want to do this?
All right.
But like,
I'm
intimately familiar with their income.
But I've read their annual report.
They'll be talking about sponsored. Percentage of a different figure, because that's just not true. It's 40% state, 40% trading. And it means so much to misrepresent it. Does a service to the company.
It does a disservice to the company.
It does a service.
Okay, well, let's get into that in discussion, because I think that maybe we need to go backwards and forwards on that a bit more, but rather than in this situation. But the sponsorship of Tate is enmeshed within exactly the same kind of value of assemblage creation as the one that I've just described in more abstract terms. So the question is how we involve ourselves in that. And Mel has obviously given us one example of an involvement. Yeah, but there might be other ways of involving ourselves. And I would like to suggest that one of the ways that we need to involve ourselves is to think about how state funding structures and private donations to institutions need to be more fully understood as an enmeshed politics. So what I want to talk about now is a couple of examples, and I'm going to just touch on them very briefly, of recent Arts Council of England initiatives, funding initiatives, and to talk about them as ways in which value is produced and accrued, which is different from or exceptional to the modes through which it would like to have itself performed, in a sense. And the first of these, and I don't know whether people are familiar with these, maybe you can tell me or not, is the case for the Creative Case for Diversity, which is now a funding imperative that all Arts Council funded, all state funded organisations have to answer to in order to receive their money. Have people heard of the Creative Case for Diversity? Have people had to fill in their NPO? The National Portfolio Organisation applications recently in terms of answering to this. People familiar with this? Who is? Who isn't? Some people are. Yeah, lots of people are. Okay. So the Creative Case for Diversity was launched a couple of years ago by Peter Bazalgette, who was the outgoing chair of the Arts Council, as a way in which questions of ethnicity and gender and ability should be written into the state structures of the arts through employment and representational exhibitions and events and performances within all state institutions. Now, of course, some institutions have been doing this for a long time. Other people were answerable to something and had to change quite a lot of what they did. But, of course, it's one thing to kind of write what you're going to do on a funding application. It's another thing to kind of internalise those very important ideological changes in your own institution. So there's the Creative Case for Diversity. And the second thing that I want to talk about, or mention effectively, is another funding. Oh God, where is it? I'm going up and down from all my notes here. Is the Creative Peoples and Places Fund. Have people come across the Creative Peoples and Places Fund? Anybody? Less information, less knowledge of it. Okay, so the Creative Peoples and Places Fund was again launched a couple of years ago. And of course, this is very specific to the English, sometimes the UK, but sometimes the English funding structure. And the Creative Peoples and Places Fund is described in this way by the Arts Council. Creative People and Places is about more people choosing, creating, and taking part in brilliant art experiences in the places where they live. Funded by Arts Council England, there are now 21, this was a year ago, so there might be more now, 21 independent creative people and places projects in areas where people have fewer opportunities to get involved with the arts. The projects work with a diverse range of partners, including a rugby club, a haulage firm, and housing associations, as well as artists and arts organisations. Okay, so these are, again, I'm very happy to talk more about the specifics of this, but I don't want to go into more detail of the particular kind of partnerships with haulage firms and things in this particular talk, because there isn't time. But what I want to say is that these institutionalized inclusions are really wrapped together with the imperatives for private funding of arts institutions. So rather than being forms that would suggest that arts funding is opening itself up to different voices and to different ways of thinking through the distribution of money within the arts system, specifically within the UK/England, because some of these apply to the England and some of them apply to the UK as a whole. It, rather than seeming to be an opening up, an opportunising of other voices and other ideas within the arts, this is rather a way of revanchising or making into property the forms and ideas of people that the art structures haven't yet tapped in order to create more value, and that value attracts more private property, I mean a more private sponsorship, and therefore more proprietal understandings of what the construction, the economic construction of art is. So they are all forms of revanchism, ways to recover lost ground, specifically within the arts, but more importantly, for social and political power. So we need to understand state funding and its relationship to private funding, its increasingly imperativized relationship to private funding, including the funding that comes through private hires to institutions such as universities, as a form of political appropriation. So within that structure, how might we change things? How might we manage change? Well, obviously it would seem to me that the way we need to manage change is to think about the structures of arts institutions rather than their content. 5 minutes, thank you. That's great. Rather than their content. So it's one thing to fill a gallery, and I'm going to be very simplistic here. It's one thing to fill a gallery with critical content. It's another thing to enter into the institution and ask for, and this comes back to company accounts and things like that, which Mel has also obviously been very invested in investigating, and there are probably people in the room that runs institutions that are also very familiar with this, and looking at the way in which people are paid, looking at who's paid, and looking about the ways in which the structures, the economic structures of the institution might be able to change and might have to spend a long time instigating that change. So might have to spend 20 years in order to change practices, social and political practices within institutions at the structural level, rather than in terms of reproducing critique within the gallery, performance, theatre spaces, which I think we've learned doesn't change many things. So arts institutions like the ICA contribute to arts normative value mechanics, and they're caught at the moment between these two pivotal value creators: one, the private sponsorship, and two, the state. And the state money is running out and being diversified, as the creative case for the creative case is doing, and as creative people and places is doing. You'll note that the term creative pops up all the time. I think, actually, personally, the term creative should be banned from the English language. Okay, so what do we negotiate? What are we left to negotiate between these two as political imperatives that are instituted through neoliberal statist practices? Okay, the incorporation of the private into the public being Foucault's definition of neoliberalism. So how do we change them? Stefano Harney, the management theorist, says this, and it's quite a complex, it's one line, but it took me a while to work it out, so let me try and unpick it. First, the quote. So Stefano Harney says this: what organisations are able to become has strictly to do with what is already in motion and what captures a form that can then be presented as an organisation. So you can see it's a kind of amoeba. He's trying to describe a kind of amoeba strip. Is that right? Is that amoeba strip? Yeah, it is. So what organisations become is precisely what they're enabled to become through the institutional formations, and I'm describing those as private and public, that are in operation around them. So if I unpick it a bit more, we can say that what Stefano Harney is saying is that, firstly, organisations can only become what the culture in which they are formed allows them to be, This allows, it's not just regulatory in terms of policy, but it's regulatory at a political and hegemonic level. Policy is a tool used, and this is something that Stefano Harney talks about a lot, policy is a tool used for shaping the values of a culture. And this is why I'm interested in schemes from the Arts Council, like the Creative Caves and Creative Places and People. But he's also saying this, and forgive me for this on a Saturday afternoon when we should probably all be watching the rugby, organisations capture a form from those already in motion. So the forms that the institution captures are the ones that are there, that are in motion. Yeah, that seems to make sense to me. This movement is the political culture of a state, a territory, a boundary, or an aesthetic. So given that this is a description that would seem to make sense, how can we change the ways in which that form that is out there, that is captured, that is identified and normalized hegemonically through organizations like the Arts Council, and the way in which they legally write in private sponsorship or corporate sponsorship into their models, okay? Because, of course, legislation is something that is absolutely pivotal in the shaping capacity. The law shapes the modes through which we think about the dissemination and the congregation around art within Western cultures. How can we think about changing things? Well, just in my last few minutes, I'm going to mention a project that I'm involved in at the moment at CASCO, which is the Office for Theory, Art and Design that's based in Utrecht in the Netherlands. People familiar? Some people familiar with CASCO? Yeah, okay. So I'm working with the directors. I mean, they've been working for a long time, and I am very much involved in a kind of collective process here. That has been instigated by an artist called Annette Krauss, called Unlearning. So what the institution is doing, and this is a state-funded organisation in the Netherlands that probably receives about the same amount of money as the ICA, largely because it's smaller, but there's more money in the Netherlands at the moment. It also receives money from the Mondrian Foundation. And what they're trying to work out is if a state-funded organisation run on the basis of the financial and aesthetic shaping mechanisms, the Stefano Harney's Mebus strip, because that's the legal imperativization that comes when you are contracted through a state funder, along with the ways in which you can receive private capital, if it can change to produce equality for its workers. So this is very kind of, this is looking at documents and working out what's possible and what's not possible and buying people in who have more skills in this area than you have because you're just an academic and a utopian and blah, 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 blah. So it's quite, and it's boring and it's long-term and it's invisible work, okay? But what we've been looking at in this with Annette and the workers of CASCO is how budgets can be made transparent. This again goes back to some of the things that Mel was referring to today. How collective decision making can be implemented, and how organisational structures can be refashioned in ways that incorporate questions about capital and value creation at the core of the organisation. Now, it's very difficult, and CASCO is an interesting example of an organisation that is attempting, and has for a long time, those of you that are familiar with it will know that for a long time it's been trying to reinvent its relationship to power, leadership and authority within a very defined funding situation, not dissimilar to the one that people in this room that are funded or work with UK organisations are used to, UK arts institutions. So whilst CASCO has to have a director and curators, etc., etc., it has to have a board of trustees that monitor its movements in terms of in terms of what it can be enabled, what it is enabled to do, and the trustees employ the director, etc., etc. So a very similar structure to UK state institutions. As well as being the impartial advisors, as well as being so it's looking at the ways in which unlearning can work as a collaboration within the organisation, and they take as the starting point Gayatri Spivak's idea that she talks about in the book of her text called Aesthetic Education, unlearning privileges. So this is something that's very important for them. But, and I'm going to end with a quote from their website, CASCO, because in the grappling with this, they've come to lots of standstills. They've come up against full stops. They find they can't move. They find themselves in a really difficult place, and a place that is absolutely governed by legal frameworks and jurisdictions around what state funding enables and doesn't enable, despite the fact that in the Netherlands, just like the UK, there are these nominally transgressive schemes like Creative Peoples and Places. So they say this: the main question we've been exploring in our weekly unlearning discussions is what we could unlearn to institute in more communal ways of working. CASCO's public front, meaning its exhibitions, events, research projects and publications, propose the commons as a viable alternative to capitalism. If we adhere to the motto that we should practice what we share with the public, the back of the organisation should be a sound reflection of what you, the viewer, sees and hears from us. Yeah, so you get that. Maybe the ICA should also be like that. The question then arises, how do we deal with the contradiction between having a responsibility to the public in a neoliberal society, CASCO is a public institution after all, and the desire to unlearn many of the core values of neoliberalism? What is the role of the artist in all of this, and how can we actively practice a commons-based approach in our daily work? So I think the rethinking we need to do starts at these very core questions of value creation within institutions. And we need to work closely with the directors and curators, many of whom I hope are in this room, to support a trans-historical realignment of the value creation of arts institutions within these frameworks in order to move questions of capital and capitalization away from the place that they're currently stuck, which is simply in a recognition that value is created through the discussion and dissemination of contemporary art. Thank you very much.
Try and rehearse this line of reasoning and make some kind of contact with Dave's project. So I start with this deferred value. So this was first elaborated in this publication from Common Practice in 2011. And the project comes out of a network of small scale arts organizations attempting to come up with a rhetoric with which they can negotiate or lobby or secure recognition for their contribution from various funding agencies, particularly central government public funding. And so the lines are things like, we need to develop ways of measuring a wider variety of types of value being delivered by small visual arts organizations. The phenomenon of deferred value, whereby the value created by an initiating organization is realized long after a commission has moved beyond its jurisdiction. So the idea is that the small-scale organization invests in commissioning, initiating a project that then maybe sometime later, perhaps decades later, appears in the orbit of something like Tate, and the value capture is done by the larger organization, whereas the small-scale organisation's contribution to this value chain is not necessarily legible or recognised, particularly within the existing metrics. So the kind of argumentation reads like this. I won't dwell on it too long, but the key thing in terms of recognising how large organisations capture this value, they develop the ideas or re-exhibit the works first commissioned by smaller organisations, are unlikely to have contributed to this initial production, but they are well placed to realise the deferred value in the work through audience figures, ticket income, associated secondary spend, larger readership and related advertising income. So this deferred value construct is an attempt to try and produce something which can in some way become amenable to metrics, and thereby become policy relevant and thereby become the basis to secure more resources. Now, in the development of this argument, I won't go into too much detail here, but in the development of this argument, in subsequent work by Common Practice, this deferred value construct has been problematized. So when Rebecca Gordon-Nesbitt, in summarizing a subsequent discussion within the forum, begins to identify a certain problem with this deferred value construction, and notes that perhaps inevitably in a capitalist society, all of these conceptions of value tend ultimately to be realized in commercial terms. So she proceeds with, if we linger on definitions of value that are commercially inflected, the work undertaken by small organizations, which consistently display non-commercial tendencies, will either evade measure or tend to fall foul of performance indicators ill-suited to its unique strengths and particularities. So the concept of deferred value is seen as problematic, but what I want to pick up on, I'll try and make this a little bit shorter to make up for time, but what I'm trying to pick up on is that this discussion of deferred value and its contestation, there's an ambivalence running through it, and the ambivalence is whether there are ways in which rhetorically, ways in which one may speak about art and value persuasively without denaturing that which is being valued. So can you produce a rhetoric to articulate the question of value which doesn't denature art, and specifically the anxiety being that everything once thematized as value will end up being thematized as exchange value. And in these discussions, it's quite interesting to note, there's a tendency, albeit in a very compressed way, to produce a kind of historicization, to present this problem as something that is in some sense timeless, or at least very, very old. So we have the reference to Plato, to kind of, it reads slightly strangely in these very compressed documents. Or you have the reference to Larpalar arguments of the 19th century. What I want to do is to pick up on a more, these notes are not for you, these are for me. what I want to pick up is a more recent precedent than Plato or the 19th century, which is to pick up an argument that emerged in the context of the mass culture debates of the mid-20th century in New York. And this runs parallel to the kind of German debate from the 30s, but it has a different kind of inflection because of a certain self-consciousness about the appropriation of European high culture into an American colonial context. One of the contributions to this debate, which I think has not sufficiently been kind of contextualized within that debate, but one of the important contributions to this debate is a piece by Hannah Arendt on the crisis in culture. And she, in this text, she talks about the problem of mass culture and the anxieties about kind of inauthenticity, a degradation of cultural value, etc. She talks about this as having a prehistory outside of the terms of mass media. And she points to a disintegration of culture whose lasting monuments are the neoclassic, the neo-Gothic, and the neo-Renaissance structures that are strewn all over Europe. So basically pointing to a problem of the 18th and the 19th century. In this disintegration, culture, more even than other realities, had become what only then people began to call value. That is, a social commodity which could be circulated and cashed in exchange for all kinds of other values, social and individual. Now, Arendt is operating a concept of commodity and circulation which is not within a Marxist framework. It's clearly informed by reading Marx, but she's not operating a Marxist conceptual apparatus. She goes on to say, in other words, cultural objects were first despised as useless by the Philistine until the cultural Philistine seized upon them as a currency by which he bought a higher position in society or acquired a higher degree of self-esteem, higher, that is, than in his own opinion he deserved, either by nature or by birth. In this process, cultural values were treated like any other values. They were what values always have been, exchange values. And in passing from hand to hand, they were worn down like old coins. They lost the faculty, which is originally peculiar to all cultural things, the faculty of arresting our attention and moving us. When this had come about, people began to talk of the devaluation of values, and the end of the whole process came with the bargain sale of values during the 20s and 30s in Germany, the 40s and 50s in France, when cultural and moral values were sold out together. So what I'm trying to capture here in the Arendt text is that a discourse on values will only ever become a transposition to exchange values. That's the anxiety that haunts the deferred value discussions, and it's the explicit concern or claim that Arendt makes, that inevitably once you start talking values, you end up sooner or later in the question of exchange values. And to transactions of reductive exchange, that a discourse on cultural values is already compromised, already in the process of denaturing what it attempts to name and disclose. So I'm not proposing that Arendt is correct. Rather, I just want to try and read what she's saying in a slightly different way. And hopefully by this, I'd like to make some contact with Dave's book. So firstly, to note that in Arendt's text, there is an anticipation of something like Bourdieu's cultural capital, symbolic capital analyses, here with a different tendency, where Arendt tends to absolutize and universalize the construction art. So Arendt asserts that the artist is, after all, the authentic producer of those objects which every civilization leaves behind as the quintessence and the lasting testimony of the spirit which animated it. So in contrast to this construction of art and artists, Arendt positions her analysis of the emergence of a discourse on cultural values within a broader historicization of bourgeois social ontology. She says mass society and mass culture seem to be interrelated phenomenon, but their common denominator is not the mass, but rather the society. But their common denominator is not the mass, but rather the society into which the masses too have been incorporated. Historically as well as conceptually, mass society was preceded by society, and society is no more a generic term than mass society. It too can be dated and described historically. It is older, to be sure, than mass society, but not older than the modern age. So what I'm trying to get at here is that I think Arendt is proposing that society is not a timeless, absolute category or construction. It's not an invariant dimension of world. And in this much I would agree with her, but I would also propose to further generalize and extend this point and propose that the typical fourfold mapping that we have of world, the social, the economic, the cultural, the political, which is the key grid that is now operative within our Western developed discourses, this is the key grid we have in which to apprehend world, that this must also be historicized and not universalized. And we do universalize when we anthropologize and we speak of other societies, other cultures, other polities, other economies. And what I think, and I think this is something that Dave approaches in a slightly different way, and I'd like to maybe problematize it a little bit if possible. But what this means is that the historically specific production of a system of ideas and practices, art, the arts, the aesthetic, I would propose was substantially a process of contesting the rise of a new ordering of world according to the emergent hegemony of profit makers and profit making. So we see that the construction of the aesthetic, the construction of art, is something that emerges as a response to the hegemony of a profit making kind of construction of world. In the attempt to challenge or resist the profit making discourse on value, there is an attempt to construct a counter discourse on values, a discourse on other non-profit-making values. And a generative move within that attempt to construct a counter discourse of other values was to format a new constellation of ideas, practices, the arts, the aesthetic. And where I would maybe seek to difference a little bit from Dave's position is where he constructs a kind of ontology of art, a historicized ontology, but one that takes us to the Renaissance, and I think in a way that maybe I would like to think that history a little bit differently in terms of pointing rather to the consolidation of categories of the aesthetic in the 18th century as being something that is not already seeded in the genealogy of the Renaissance, that there's something else comes into play. However, such a counter-discourse of other values is always vulnerable to capture by transposition into exchange. It can be sold out, something that has haunted the discourse on other values since it began. And I'm thinking here of Martha Woodmansey's work on the interests in disinterestedness, looking at how key category of aesthetic analysis in the late 18th century is elaborated in the context of writers engaged in a dispute over the relationship between writing and the market for writings. And I point to this as being part of the same continuity of an anxiety about how a discourse of other values always gets, or always has the potential to be recouped as a discourse on exchange values. Now, to bring this more thoroughly into contact with Dave's thesis on the economic exceptionalism of art, I think what Dave has done, which is really important, is that I think he has attempted to address a question of the kind of exceptional economy, the economic exceptionalisms of art, in a way that gets past any kind of nostalgic romanticism, in a way that gets past any kind of special pleading, in favour of a really substantive analysis of a relationship with capital, not simply capitalism, a relationship with a mode of production, and the question of what is the mode of production of art. And okay, within this, we have the in the concluding phase, we have this proposition, beauty is a non-economic value. So where I would trouble this is that I think that it is in the nature of the development of capital that it has always, so far, it has always found ways to extract value irregardless of what is the nature of the underlying substratum that it wishes to extract value from. And I think that the claim that within the economic exceptionalism of art, that there's the possibility of a resistance. I accept that there is a possibility, but I would like to counter it with there is also the possibility that this is eminently recuperable by a strategy of value extraction. So that rather than, so maybe that's what we've been seeing in the cases described earlier, where we see how if we think of maybe the question of art's proposition of a different discourse of value, a possibility of other values, if we see that as something which can be capitalized en masse, So you don't capitalize the individual artistic production, but you capitalize that proposition, and you can extract value from it. And I think that's what we're seeing in, say, the public relations culture of the oil companies as one small example. But I don't think we should foreclose, I don't think we should shut down the speculation on that there is a possibility here. But I think we need to be super cautious given the success of capital in elaborating mechanisms for the extraction of value in ways that completely override the underlying nature of the things being subsumed. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Straight to the floor. Astrid, if you could just move the roaming mic back to the speakers.
I'll do that,
questions.
And I will actually give the floor to myself first. If you don't mind. Usually I don't speak very much during these events because I like to give the audience a chance to ask questions. But since some things were said about the ICA, I'd like to just set the record straight. This is not a private hire. We do have private hires. This is not a private hire. This is an event that we worked on in partnership. Of course, some events are more collaborative than others. This event was maybe slightly less collaborative. But it wouldn't have happened if we didn't think that this was something that we wanted to have part of the ICA program. I also wanted to say Mondrian Fonds is actually the Dutch government funding. They're the same thing. And now, any questions? Matt, did you
there's a question on the floor. Probably, yeah.
Yes, it's a question about just in relation to the idea of the construction of the aesthetic.
It's a question for Mick.
Yeah, for Mick, in response to the profit-making world. I'm wondering when Mick's talking about historically.
Your mic's gone dead, sorry.
Can you hear me
now? Yeah, I can hear you now.
So, Mick, could you just unpack a little bit more
what you're talking about
there? You're talking about the century?
So, Astrid, can the other mic come back down here to Mick, or is this running out of battery? So the question was, you know, sort of in terms of this notion of aesthetics that you're bringing to the fore here, you know, sort of can you unpack it a bit more in terms of the overall extrapolations that you're making between these nodal structures?
The proposition being that rather than the categories of the aesthetic are elaborated in the 18th century. And that they're elaborated in a context where there's an attempt to produce discussions of value which are not the values of the market. And there is an adoption of the theme of the aesthetic as the principle under which the various fine arts can be unified. But the system of the fine arts is elaborated prior to the elaboration of the just the idea of the aesthetic. And there's a very specific set of conjunctions. I pointed to the one of that Woodmansey analyzes in looking at debates about different types of writing, a writing that was servicing the demands of a readership and a writing that was not pandering to a readership. And this was thematized in relation to the idea of interests. So you hear the terms of capital in interests and interestedness. They're not exactly collapsing to each other, but there is a clear resonance here. And what my proposal is that if we understand art not as a timeless propensity of humans, but rather as a historically specific construction informed by the rise of a discourse on value which reduces all value to exchange value. And I think that that's a very crude summary, but I think that that's something that maybe needs to be taken into consideration when we start to look at the claims for the economic exceptionalisms of art. And I don't think in this position I'd be radically different from Dave, I just think it's a different degree of emphasis on that historicization.
I mean, it's a while since I read that Woodmansey article, but if I remember rightly, she's talking about authors and hackneyed writing, isn't she? And she, are you suggesting that that somehow there is not an interest in disinterestedness against her? and that this, because it seems to me that she's saying precisely the opposite of you.
I concur with her position. It is to see that there are interests in the construction of disinterestedness, but to see also that the larger impetus to construct a discourse on the aesthetic is framed by the attempt to construct a counter discourse of value responding to the impact of the success of capital in establishing a singular discourse of value in terms of profit making. So I think we would agree in our reading of her text.
Okay.
Thank you. Is there any... Well, I'll take one more question, so you can sort of... if we can move...
Sorry, should I be asking this question or passing the mic down?
Which person is speaking?
Was that your question?
I know, you can sort of ask, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. This is a very interesting debate that I think Mick is opening up here, because the very same argument, or the very same terms of the argument, are often used to sort of establish, in fact, the historical time together, precisely of the rise of sort of capitalist sort of social relations, and the sort of generalisation of those in the sort of 18th century, the beginning of the generalisation of them, and the aesthetic. So it's often used to do exactly the opposite of what you're sort of pressuring on here. So I think that's just an observation, and we obviously don't have time to talk about it a great deal. The question I had, you said you were going to move to the American context, and we had Hannah Arendt. And it made me think a lot that we're really dealing with Arendt, but also with Adorno and Horkheimer, also with Brecht, that bifurcation, as it were, of the German discourses or Middle European discourses and what's going on in the United States are not, in fact, separate. In fact, part of what one's dealing with is the encounter, precisely, of émigré intellectuals with the American culture. So I just wondered if you might talk a little bit more about that. And I'm sort of thinking also that perhaps one of the things that one's missing in this as well, an additional thing that one might add to it, is in fact the whole sort of anti-colonial or crisis of imperialism. So there's a sort of globalised question that's also opening up in terms of the anxieties about mass culture that is being set within this larger sort of global situation, and also this transatlantic sort of encounter.
Okay, so that's it. There's a massive demand as a question at this point, so if you maybe try and sort of be relatively...
I would argue for, of course these two debates overlap, and of course Arendt is a particular bridge, but I would argue that Arendt's position is shaped precisely by the encounter with the New York intellectual tradition and precisely their anxieties around the high culture as this European thing that doesn't quite fully, is not native to America. And so I do think that's an important difference in how these arguments unfold in Dwight MacDonald and others, yeah, relative to how it unfolds in Horkheimer and Adorno. But in terms of this, the other thing, the reason I was invoking that particular moment is also to do precisely with the way in which we are reluctant to have our discussion of the economy of art within this wider sector of the cultural industry. So, this is precisely the tendency of central government, this is where the policy goes to talk this way, but we're reluctant to recognize in our discourse that actually, if we isolate art, visual art production, a particular moment of it, from all this other stuff, it can look a particular way, but it might look quite differently if we saw that the sector we're dealing with is precisely the sector as construed by central government policy. And I think this is why that particular moment is of interest. And then the third issue, which I think is really, really important that you point to, is my concern is that we are universalizing the category art, that it is part of the things that have conditioned globalization. It's really clear that there is a colonial imperial project underway with this, and that needs to be problematized. And we can't problematize it if we assume that the Greeks had it, the Egyptians had it, the Native North Americans had it, we all have it, it's art. And that tends to surface it underneath our ways of speaking at the moment.
Thank you, Andrew Phillips and Mick Wilson.